Yeah, hello guys, this week can start. I hope you can all hear me well. This talk is quite technical, so please don't hesitate to interrupt and ask questions. Okay? So, just a few short words about who I am. I'm currently owning my own consultancy called Coffee Consulting, funny name for a company. I'm based in Sofia, and I'm one of the best organizers of the events of the Bulgarian Japanese group.
We gather once or twice a month. We also have our own community conference, pretty much similar to JBCN, and I hope you're enjoying this conference. I'm also part-time OpenJDK and Oracle database contributor. I'm very fond of playing around with the Oracle database. So you can also find me on that topic and ask me questions after this talk. I'm also an author of a book called Learning Rabbit MQ. So I'm also very fond of messaging brokers, and if you're interested in RabbitMQ, you can also have a discussion after the session. And at the moment, I'm also writing a book on Java 9, so this is a work in progress, so it will be expected to be finished by the end of the year. So in this talk, I want to discuss with you and tell you a short story about how does the Java security model evolve throughout the versions of the Java platform. So, as I mentioned, the talk is quite technical, so please don't hesitate to interrupt me and ask me questions. So, the topic is divided into several brief parts. The first one is basically a discussion on what is the Java Security Sandbox model? How does it work? And basically, how can you use it in your daily job? So, how many of you know what a security manager in Java is? No? Okay, so I hope you'll learn from this talk. In the second part, we'll discuss what are the supporting security utilities that contribute to the Java security architecture. So apart from the Java security sandbox model, we have a number of utilities provided by the JDK that you can use to establish different mechanisms such as authentication, authorization, cryptography, and so on and so forth. And in the end, we'll see some best practices in applying this knowledge when you develop and basically design your Java applications. So, let's see what is essentially the evolution of the Java security model. From time immemorial, basically, companies try to protect their assets. For example, when a developer starts working for a large enterprise or a software company, in many cases, he has to be aware of the security policy of that company. So companies are trying to protect both their software and hardware assets. They're setting up firewalls, antivirus system, intrusion protection, intrusion detection systems, and any type of system that can block access to the external world from your company. However, with the evolution of technologies such as, for example, Java applets, for example, you can think of .NET Swing as well. So basically, with the emerging technologies, a whole new range of security vulnerabilities rise on the horizon. And this basically includes the ability to execute arbitrary code from your browser on the computer machine. So in order to cope with that type of problem, basically, how can you protect your machines from code that can be executed from the browser, or basically any system that allows you to execute arbitrary code on the system, the Java Security Sandbox model starts to evolve. And we'll cover it by looking at a particular use case, and that is Java applets. So basically, the goal of the Java Security Sandbox model is to allow us to execute untrusted source code from any type of managed system, for example, the user browser, on a particular machine. So basically, the Java Sandbox model provides a controlled environment that allows you to specify different set of permissions that are applied to your applications. So let's look at details. In version 1.0 of the Java platform, the model was quite simple. We had the system code, which were all of the classes that constituted the JDK, and we had external applets that might be run inside the browser. And in that regard, the system protection domain was divided in two parts, trusted and untrusted. Basically, all of the source code that executed inside the JDK that was running in the browser was deemed as trusted, meaning that it could do everything with the system of the user. It could delete files, it could open network connections, and so on and so forth. However, strict restrictions were applied to the untrusted domain, which were the applets. So basically, the same set of permissions was applied to all of the applets that were executed on the particular machine. However, this was not very flexible. So as you can see, we have two domains. We have only the trusted and untrusted domain. And we can have two particular set of permissions for each one of them. So basically, strict restrictions were applied by default on the untrusted domain, which were those applets that you loaded inside the user browser. However, as the guys at CERN realized that this was not a very flexible model, they wanted to introduce a more flexible model that would tackle this problem. So in version 1.1 of JDK, the notion of so-called signed applet was introduced. So basically, the idea was the following. We don't want to make all applets untrusted in our system. We want to specify that we trust a particular set of applets that can do more things on our systems. And in that regard, in order to make these applets trusted, we needed a mechanism to allow them to do whatever they want on the system. And that was the mechanism of signed applets. So in order to sign an applet, there was a very short process that we'll see briefly. But in general, now with version 1.1 of the JDK, local code and signed applets were deemed as trusted. And still, there were a set of applets that were untrusted or unsigned. So here is the process of applet signing. You compile the applet file, you create a jar file for the applets in the usual manner. You generate a pair of public-private keys using any appropriate tool for the purpose. Then you sign the applet jar with the private key. Then you export a certificate for your public key file and optionally place this certificate in a Java trust store. Then you import that certificate as a trusted certificate in the trusted store. Create a policy file. We'll see what the policy file looks like. And finally, you load and run that applet. So this was the process in version 1.1 that allowed you to make your applets trusted. However, as you can see, this is still not very flexible at all. So in version 1.2 of the platform, there was a radical change in the security model of the Java platform. No more notion of trusted and untrusted source code. And so the guys at CERN decided that they need to provide a much more flexible mechanism that would allow you to specify different set of permissions for different set of applications that were loaded by the JVM. So in that regard, the security manager and access controller classes were introduced. And their basic purpose was basically to allow you to check permissions of a particular application that is running inside the JDK. So in that particular example here, I have some applets that might be loaded, for example, from the conference site of JBCN. And I can specify some particular permissions on that applet. And that permissions are specified in the so-called security.policy file, which by default resides in the installation of the JDK. But you can move it and you can specify a different location of that file. And inside that file I specify grant code base, and I specify the location of that applet. And I specify a set of permissions that apply to this applet. In this particular case, I specify the file permission, which allows me to delete the cWindows folder. So basically, permissions in the JDK were constituted of three parts. The type of the permission, in this particular case, that is file permission. The target, in that particular case, this is the cWindows folder. And the third part was the action. What can I do with this? This is the delete action. So this would allow me to delete the cWindows folder. So this was a very flexible model, as it allowed me, now in version 1.2, to specify particular permissions for particular applets. And as you can see, this is much more flexible than what we had beforehand. And now the security model becomes more code-centric. So basically, you now need to know what's the location of your loaded application. In that particular case we saw, the location was JBCNConf/demoapplet. So basically, this is how the JVM determines how to set permissions on the particular application by seeing that what's the location of all of the classes that are loaded. And basically, access control permission decisions are specified now in the security policy file, as we saw. And there was no more the notion of trusted and untrusted source code. However, a new term was introduced, which is valid up to date, and that's the notion of a protection domain. Has anyone heard of protection domain in the JDK? No? Okay, let's describe it briefly. So a protection domain basically constitutes of two things. The location of where your class is being loaded from, for example, this could be the location of all classes loaded from the demo applet we saw, and also the set of permissions that apply to that class. So basically, that is the protection domain of a class, the location from where that class is loaded, and the set of permissions that applies to this class. And now we also have two types of protection domains. These were system and application, pretty much similar to what we had earlier with the trusted and untrusted domain. Now, system domain basically allows us to load applications from the JDK directly. So all of the classes that were loaded in the JDK were under the system protection domain. And all of the classes that were loaded from external applications, such as applets, are in the application domain. And basically, you can retrieve that protection domain by calling the instance of your instance.getClass.getProtectionDomain. And out of that protection domain, you can check where your class is being loaded from, or what are the set of permissions that apply to this class when he is loaded inside the JVM. And the protection domain essentially is set during class loading. So when you load your classes, the JVM sets the particular protection domain on the class instance that's being loaded, along with the set of active permissions. One interesting property that applies to those permissions is that they imply each other. For example, earlier I specified for the demo applet that I can delete the cWindows folder, and this automatically applies that I can also delete the cWindows system32 folder. So permissions imply each other, and this is very important to realize, because sometimes when you set a permission, without realizing, you can specify more permissions than you typically want. Another interesting property is that also the location of where classes are loaded from may imply other locations. So if I specify in the properties file that I'll be applying permissions for that location here, jbcnconf.com, this automatically applies that all of these permissions will apply to the location jbcnconf.com/demoapplet. So basically, the location also may imply other types of locations. To give you a particular example of this, let's assume that you have a Java EE application server. And the Java EE application server may load different types of applications, which are loaded by in terms of different class loaders. As we mentioned earlier, the protection domain of an application is set during class loading. So you may have different types of protection domains through which your source code executes. One protection domain would be that of the classes loaded in the application server. And the other protection domain will be that of the classes loaded from your WAR file, for example. So how do you determine the set of permissions in that case? Well, what the folks at CERN decided is that the protection domain in that case will be the intersection of permissions through which your active thread walks. So basically, the set of permissions for a particular class that's executed inside an application server, that's some class from your WAR file, would have a protection domain which is the intersection of the protection domain for the WAR file, for the location of which that WAR file is loaded from, and the location of the application server. So this is an interesting property of the permission sets. So moving on, in version 1.3 and 1.4, basically the security model stayed the same. We had the protection domain with the set of permissions that applied to a particular class. However, we didn't have any way to specify who is the user running the class. Basically, we didn't have a way to specify who is actually executing the class. And in that regard, something called JAS was introduced. How many of you know what JAS is? Yeah, what's JAS? JAS? Yeah, so it's Java Authentication and Authorization Service, yeah, the name. Basically, the purpose of JAS was not to extend the security model in the Java platform, but to provide a mechanism that you can use to specify how to authenticate your application in the JVM and how to authorize that application. So basically, JAS was strictly divided into two parts. The first part was the authentication part, which actually was quite pluggable. So the authentication part of JAS implemented pluggable authentication modules, which allow you to specify different mechanisms for authentication, for example, through an LDAP server, through a relational database, and so on and so forth. And the authorization part in JAS was the one that allowed you to specify to which user what set of permissions do apply. And the authorization part of JAS is the one that actually extends the security sandbox model of the Java platform. Let's consider the same example. we have some applet that's been loaded from the site of the JBCN conference, the same demo applet. And in that case, the security policy file syntax is extended. We specify grant principle and the name of the principle. In that particular case, this principle means some property of the user. And this means that I'll be authorizing a user, an LDAP user, which is an X500 principle, that has a CN attribute equal to Tom. And that user, with that particular property, will have the permission to delete the CNUs folder. So now, apart from the location of where our classes are being loaded from, we could set also some principles or some attributes of the user that runs the particular class. And it's a matter of view, basically how you establish the authentication of your application and the set of principles that applies to the particular application. And yeah, as we already mentioned, just basically extends the security model with role-based permissions, meaning that you can specify some attributes of the user that have particular permissions. And also the protection domain of the class now contains not only the code source of the class, or basically the location of where the class is loaded from, and the set of permissions, but also a list of permissions, a list of principles, which is a set of attributes for your user. This could be an email address, a username. So basically you can think of a principle as a synonym of an attribute. Now we have three particular things in the protection domain: the location of the class, the principles or attributes of the user, and the location of that particular class. And it's the authentication component of Just that extends the security architecture of the Java platform. Basically, you can use Just also in a Java application server, so it's a framework that's not targeted to extend the JDK itself. However, the authorization part of Just actually extends the security policy file as we saw earlier. And here are the core classes of JAS that can serve as a recap for you of what JAS is. We have a particular subject class which represents the user in our system. And the starting point for authenticating that user is using the login context class. The login context class allows you to manage multiple authentication modules inside your application. So you might have a login module which is a LDAP login module, relational database login module, and so on and so forth. The JDK comes by default with several predefined login modules, for example, for Kerberos, for LDAP, and several others that you can use. Once you have a login module that specifies how can you authenticate the user to a particular external system, you can authenticate the user and create a subject instance which represents the user. And that subject instance may have one or more principles, which are the attributes of the user. This could be the email address, username, and so on and so forth. So this is in general how JAS works. Once you have this subject instance, you set it to the protection domain of your class, and now you are able to check for what types of permissions does your class has based on the user that's currently running the application. So up to JDK 1.4 now, we have the following flow for permission checking. We are starting up the system. At system startup, we set the security policy file and the security manager. You can also have your own custom mechanism, so you can check for permissions not inside the security policy file, but you can implement your own mechanism. For example, the Oracle database implements something interesting, and that is to store permissions inside a relational table inside the database. Because Oracle database allows you to run Java stored procedures in the database, pretty much similar as transpiled SQL procedures. And the JVM that runs inside the Oracle database checks for permissions which are specified in a particular database table. And now, when you start up your application, that could be a Java server, an applet container, and so on and so forth, you set the policy and you install a security manager that will be used to check for the particular permissions of your application. So by default, the Java applications that you write don't have a security manager installed. So basically, when you run an application without a security manager installed, by default, you can do whatever you want with your system. But if you write a Java application server, it's mandatory that you install a security manager so that you can specify a particular set of permissions for the applications that run inside that application server. So the first step is to specify the policy file and to install the security manager. The second step is to load the application classes.
whether that's a JavaScript server or a browser that running the JVM, it needs to load your classes. So during the class loading phase, bytecode verification is being done on the classes to make sure that they are valid. And after that, the protection domain of that classes is being set, meaning that the permission.policy file is read. The permissions for the particular locations are being set to the protection domain, along with the principles of the user that runs the application, and the location of that particular classes. So this is how basically class loading sets up the protection domain for the classes once they are loaded. The third phase is that you execute something inside your application. So basically you try to open a connection through the network, you try to create a file on the file system, and behind the scenes, the JVM uses the security manager that you have installed in order to check whether your application has the permission to do whatever it wants to do. So permission checking is being done by the JVM or by your Java application server. If you have provided the mechanism for loading, of course, applications dynamically. Here is how basically permission checking is being done. You can do this either programmatically if you implement your own application server, or this is how basically the JDK doing permission checking behind the scenes. So we create an instance of a socket permission. This means that I'll be checking for whether I'll have the permission to open a connection on the JBCNConf site between ports 8000 and 9000. After that, I'm checking whether I have a security manager installed. And if my security manager is installed, meaning that it's not null, I'll be saying security manager.check permission. And this thing here checks whether the currently executing thread and the call stack basically has the permission to open a network connection with these parameters. So if my currently executing stack has a class which doesn't have the permission to open a connection, a security exception is being thrown, meaning that you don't have the ability to open a connection. And you need to provide a particular set of permissions for that reason. So after permission check is being done, also application code can write this thing also inside the application. So if you have a Java application server, you'll find many places where you can check whether the applications that you load inside that application server have the ability to do something. Whether they are allowed to write a log file, to use some particular service provided by the application server, and so on and so forth. We were discussing so far about applets, but this also applies, as you can see, for application servers and other types of managed systems in Java, such as OSGI as well. So basically, the OSGI specification, for example, specifies a particular set of how permission checking should be done inside an OSGI container, and it uses basically the same security manager mechanism to do so. Okay? And basically here is the same example, but not with the security manager class, but with the access controller class. So you might think, what's the difference between the two? Why should I have two particular ways to check for permissions? And the reason is because this access controller class is a new API that is being used by the security manager itself. And you can use that API without a security manager being installed. So if you don't want to install a security manager instance inside your application, you can directly use the static methods provided by the access controller class to check for particular permissions. So it's just an alternative mechanism provided by the security manager. And the security manager uses the access controller class from behind the scenes. And the fifth step also is that you can also do some privileged operations. So for example, imagine that you have a Java application server, and your application that is being loaded in the application server needs to write to a log file. And imagine that by default, the application server disallows applications to write to a log file. So what shall we do in that case? The application has the ability to write to a log file, but the protection domain of the server doesn't allow it to write to a log file. So in that case, we need to escalate the privileges of our application. So the application server must say, hey, I would allow this particular block of code that's loaded inside the application server to do this thing. So in this particular case, to write to a log file. So how can I escalate privileges of applications inside the application server?
I can execute a block of code by calling do privileged. And this means that essentially the protection domain of all of the code that's being executed will be just ignored. So I may have a particular set of permissions set for my application, but once I call access controller.doPrivileged inside the application server, I'll just ignore those permissions of the application. And that means that the application server may allow for particular operations that are not allowed on the applications to actually happen. I can do the same thing by calling subject.doSprivileged and execute the application with full privileges. Or I can execute the application as another user by calling subject.doS and provide another subject instance. So I can change the actively executing user of the application using this mechanism. I mentioned about this that Oracle Database has a particular security manager that's being installed and it's quite customizable. And it's a very interesting mechanism. If you're interested in that topic, you can check the Oracle Database documentation on how it implements a custom security manager. This is a good scenario if you want to implement your own security manager mechanism or your own mechanism to check for permissions rather than using the security policy file. But it's quite complex, so it's very error prone. This may open up some vulnerabilities in your application, so you may need to do it carefully if you want to customize this mechanism. Moving on, in JDK 1.5 and 1.6, no major changes to this security model. There were some slight changes to, for example, the support provided by LDAP, by JAS. The LDAP login module was introduced in version 1.6. There were some more extensions to the way that LDAP used login modules, but nothing more specific, so no major changes in those releases. In version 1.7 and 1.8 of the JDK, there were some enhancements. For example, the access controller do privileged method was allowed to check only against a subset of permissions. So you may escalate privileges, but you may specify a particular set of permissions to check against and not give all permissions of your application. So this is a minor change in the way that you can specify privilege escalation in version 1.8 and 1.7. And in Java 9, which we expect early 2017, as you know, there will be a module system in the Java platform. How many of you have heard of Project Jigsaw? Okay, 4 or 5 people. So basically the idea behind Project Jigsaw is that it will split the JDK into a number of modules, and it will provide developers with the ability to write modules themselves. So each module would be encapsulated in a particular format, pretty much similar to what a jar file does. And each module would be loaded from a particular location. So as you can imagine, this security model will apply directly to modules in terms of JDK 9. So once you load, let's say, a Jigsaw module from some particular location, all of the classes inside that module will have the same set of permissions as denoted by the security policy file. So Jigsaw will basically introduce a module system in Java, but the security model will apply directly to that module system, and no major changes will need to be made in order to adapt that security model in Java 9. We just mentioned about this, that modules are the ones that we understand them by Project Jigsaw, and they'll work in a pretty much similar manner as applets do in terms of security. So basically, different permissions can be specified for different Java modules. Another hidden benefit from this is now that we might have also more fine-grained access control at the system level. So now when you use a particular installation of the Java platform, you load all of the classes in the JDK. So you have more than 5,000 classes in the JDK. But now that the JDK is split into modules itself, you can specify a particular set of permissions, for example, for JAX-T or for Corba or for whatever you use from the Java platform. So this is, of course, currently not allowed. So basically, modularization of the JDK system classes would allow for this. So they would provide you with the ability to specify more fine-grained access control at the level of the JDK, which was for now not possible since we don't have any way to split the classes inside the JDK. Now, apart from the sandbox model that we just saw, there are a number of utilities that are present inside the JDK that would allow you to further provide more enhanced mechanisms and basically provide you with the ability to use the security utilities of the JDK when you need to implement some security mechanisms inside your application. So let's see briefly what are these APIs that are provided by the JDK and that fulfill the security sandbox model of the Java platform. This is just a very brief list of the utilities. We have the JCA, which is the Java cryptography architecture. It provides a set of utilities for example, for creating message digest or so on and so forth. We have the PKI or the public key infrastructure utilities, which allow you to set up your own public key infrastructure inside Java. We have the Java Secure Socket extensions, which are just an extension of the standard socket mechanism in Java through SSL. We have also the Java GSS API, or the Java Generic Security Services API, which is just a mechanism that allows you to exchange security information between the client and the server using tokens. So you may exchange tokens between the client and the server in order to exchange security information. And also you have the Java SSL API, or the Simple Authentication and Security Layer, which basically allows you to negotiate how can a client authenticate against the server. For example, the client may ask the server, hey, I want to authenticate using my email and password, do you support this? The server will say, yes, I support this. Okay, let's establish an authentication mechanism using an email address and password, for example. Let's look very briefly at each one of them. So the Java cryptography architecture, it provides you with a number of things such as, for example, creating digital signature, message digest, cryptographic shippers, and so on and so forth. Basically, the Java cryptography architecture, as most of the security APIs in the JDK, are pluggable. So you may specify your own implementation of a cryptographic algorithm and install it inside the JDK. And one particular library that provides a lot of utilities that you can use is the Bouncy Castle library. If you've had to implement something in Java in terms of security, you may have heard or have used the Bouncy Castle library. It provides a lot of implementations of various types of cryptography algorithms. The cryptography architecture of Java is a global architecture, as we mentioned. It is independent from any particular cryptography algorithm. These are provided as separate providers inside the JDK. And the Java cryptography architecture continues to evolve, meaning that more and stronger cryptographic algorithms are being provided inside the JDK. For that reason, you may also implement your own. For example, there are some countries have some particular regulations when you have to provide some cryptography in your applications. And the pluggability of the cryptography architecture allows you to specify and to implement those regulations inside the JDK in terms of separate providers. The PKI utilities. So basically, a PKI utility, just as a recap, allows you to establish a mechanism for establishing secure communication through certificates. So basically, a public infrastructure provides things such as checking whether your certificates are valid, issuing security certificates, and so on and so forth. And basically, the Java platform provides with a number of utilities that you can use in order to create certificates, to create various mechanisms to check whether those certificates are valid or not, to revoke them, and so on and so forth. And this is a very brief diagram of how certificate revocation may be implemented inside the Java platform. So we have basically two mechanisms to establish certificate revocation. This is through the so-called certificate revocation lists, which is just a file which stays on the PKI server. And that file is listed with all of the certificates that are currently revoked and should be revoked when you check against the PKI whether your security certificate is valid or not. And the other mechanism is through the OCSP protocol, which also allows you to check whether your certificate is valid or not against the public infrastructure. And the Java platform basically provides you with the utilities to create that mechanism that allows you to create your own public infrastructure if you need to do it inside the Java platform. The Java Secure Socket extension provides an implementation of SSL sockets, and it's just an extension of the standard socket mechanism in Java. and it provides some particular enhancements in newer versions of the Java platform. So basically, this is an API that's also being enhanced quite a lot. And one interesting thing is basically the ability to create virtual servers inside the same Java server instance that accepts server-side Java Secure Sockets. And that mechanism is called server name identification, which allows you to virtually divide your socket server into different domains. The GSS API, it's an alternative of the Secure Socket extension for secure communication. But as we mentioned, it uses tokens in order to exchange security authentication between the client and the server, and not opening socket connections. And the GSS framework basically also continues to evolve. So as you can see, most of the APIs that we look into are being actively supported and developed inside the Java platform. And one interesting thing about the GSS API is that it can be used along with JAS for authentication purposes. So you can integrate the authentication part of JAS with GSS. And one of the things that is being, for example, added to the latest versions of the GSS API is the support for Kerberos authentication. So the Kerberos protocol has a mechanism for authenticating using security tokens. And basically, the GSS API provides support for this. The Java SSL API, as we mentioned, is a mechanism that can establish negotiation between a client and the server on how the client should authenticate with the server. And the SSL framework basically provides concrete mechanism on how you can establish that negotiation process. The SSL API also continues to evolve, and the way in which this API evolves is in how basically security information is being exchanged, and how basically to provide support for more properties that are supported in the GSS API, more different types of systems that you can use in order to establish this security mechanism. Now, in the last part, as now we've seen what is basically the security architecture in the Java platform with the security sandbox model and supporting APIs. Let's see some interesting guidelines that every Java developer should remember when using that security manager knowledge. First of all, some of the guidelines are not bound to the Java platform itself. For example, if you've been to a security presentation, many people talk about input validation, SQL injection, type safety, and so on and so forth. So most of these guidelines do not apply to the Java language itself. However, there are some guidelines which are specific for Java, such as this one, for example. You should respect the security manager. And you should design Java libraries, if you're a library developer, that is aware of the fact that this library might be installed in a managed environment, meaning that this library might be running inside an environment where a Java EE application server, for example, is running. To give you a concrete example of this, I had a use case in the past where I wanted to use the JSON library, Google's JSON library, which provides me with the mechanism to marshal and unmarshal JSON. And the JSON library had to be used inside the OSGI bundle. Okay, sounds good. You just add the JSON library to the library part of the bundle, and you try to use it inside your OSGI bundle. And when I tried to do this, I received a security exception. And I started wondering what's going on. And looking deeper inside the source code of the JSON library, I saw that the JSON library is actually trying to use reflective APIs in order to perform some of the work. And by default, reflection didn't have, inside my OSGI container, I didn't have the ability to use reflective APIs. This was forbidden by the permissioning policy that I had in the OSGI container. So in that reason, what I had to do was basically I had to patch my OSGI, the JSON library that I had in my OSGI bundle. So I had to escalate privileges of the block that actually tried to call the reflective APIs. So by escalating the privileges inside the JSON library, I was able to run it successfully in the OSGI container. So as you can see, in that particular case, the JSON library was not aware of the fact that it can be used inside a managed environment such as OSGI. Another thing that you should remember is that you should try to grant the minimal set of permissions to your code. For example, if you have to specify permissions in the security policy file, and you, for some reason, you have a security exception, many developers just specify all permissions in order to work around the problem without caring what is the set of permissions. But as you can think of it, this is quite bad. You can have a lot of headaches later. So you just need to grant the minimal set of permissions to your applications. And of course, copy-pasting is a hazardous thing. It can distribute security bugs in multiple places. Also, another interesting guideline is that you need to sanitize exception stack traces. For example, you might be trying to open a website that was running in Java application server, and you get a nice 200 lines of stack trace inside that page. And that brings a lot of valuable information for people that can exploit. So typically, you need to make sure that you don't show the user any big stack traces in any particular case. So you may think that this could be a rule of thumb when you write your applications. Yeah, so that was it. Thank you. And any questions? No questions? Was it a difficult topic? Was it simple one thing? Okay, then thank you in that case.